Hey there, YouTube. Finally getting back to making a couple of videos here after a while, and I had some users ask me some questions. First, I had one user, and I looked for the email and I couldn't find your name, I apologize, but they were asking about using the laser and the router within the same G-code. In other words, the laser's back here, the router's up here, could they do a switch off and cut the same area using both tools in one pass without having to reload and reconfigure and all that kind of stuff? And I wanted to address that. The other thing that I had was one of my users' iPadees had a request about using M-codes, doing custom M-codes. And I started thinking about it, and I thought, you know what? This would be a good one to do a combination on. So we can make one M-code to offset between this and the laser, and another M-code to offset between the laser back to this. And then we can show how to use that inside of our code. The 15-watt blue laser is what we use to do the engraving. We need to find an offset between it and the primary cutting tool of the machine. The primary cutting tool is a 500-watt engraver spindle. This uses a rotary bit to cut through the thicker materials. It's really good for doing the things the laser can't do, which is removing larger amounts of material. Both of these items will travel around the millwork platform. The millwork platform is basically our bed that we're going to set things on to be engraved. The problem that we have is that the blue laser can only cover a portion of the platform, and the engraver can only cover a portion of the platform. There's some overlap, and in that overlap is where we can do our combined M-code. As the unit moves forward, it reaches the full front position, and the laser can't come any more forward. So the laser only has a certain area that it can reach. As the unit moves to the back, the laser now reaches the edge of the machine, and it can cover the entire blue area shown. The engraver part, however, can't get any further back than where it is now. So the pink area would represent all of the area that the engraver can reach. The purple overlap area is the only area on the machine where both the laser and the engraver can reach. So in this area, we can do more complex jobs using both tools. Our goal is simple. We need to figure out what the difference between the laser offset and the engraver origin is so that we can move back and forth between them. So let's get started. I'm going to find out what the difference is between this location and where the laser is, which is going to be somewhere around here. Okay? So I'm going to program the laser to come in and burn in a little spot. Then what I'll do is find this location and measure the difference between them. So let's go ahead and make our reference point right now. I've got my safety glasses on here. All right, and now we've got a nice mark right here. That's the new mark. And what we need to do is we need to find out what the offset is between it and the spindle. So this is our mark right here. All right, and the spindle, let's see where the spindle is. We'll do a G0, Z0, and you can see that the spindle is located right here. So what I need to do is I need to find out what the difference is between this and that. And because this current point is listed as X0, Y0, Z0, when I pick this thing up and move it in the back there, I can actually read off of the screen. So, what I'm going to do is I'm going to lift the Z up slightly, just a little bit. All right, and then I'm going to bring the machine backward. And I'm going to bring it down a little bit. That's pretty close. There. So now I've got a good reference between where this bit was and where it is now. And so now what I can do is I can take the measurement right off of the screen. I've got the thing zeroed here where the original home position was. But when we traverse over to where the laser was, you can see there's a considerable distance here. The Y is off by 194, the X only was off about 1.9. So that is the offset that we need to use to switch between the spindle location and the laser location. Once we make a routine with that offset, we can interchange between them, which means we can have one code that can do engraving and then switch over to the laser position to bring the laser down so that it's at the same point, the same reference, and then we can laser mark or vice versa. So that's what we're going to do now. I've got a piece of scrap wood here and we're going to try it. I've done several calibrations and I think I've got the measurements really good right now. So this is the zero point and I've made the new M-code, and if I enter in an M301, it'll do an offset which should bring the laser over the hole, and then if I do an M302, it should put it back. So I've taken an engraver code to make five holes and a laser code to make a test pattern, and I put them both in the same G code. And literally all I'm going to do is put my glasses on and hit go. So let's see what happens. Let's take our test pattern out and take a look at it. And as you can see, I think you can see, the laser patterns are lined up pretty darn well with the holes, which means now that I can laser mark something and then turn around and engrave it or vice versa. New toy. Okay, let me stop. We accomplished our goals. We got the thing to move from engraver to laser and back again. Two custom M codes. Now, for you casual viewers, you'll probably want to go see another video. Go find some cats or something, or look at my other videos. For you geeks and nerds like me, let's look at all the little details so you can do it too. Oh, and upcoming video, we're going to be doing a glade control panel. I'm starting to figure it out so that I can teach you. But anyway, let's do this. GoPro, stop recording. When you look up remapping, which is what we're going to be doing, you find out that they typically use it to extend G codes. And we're not going to be doing that. We're going to be doing M codes. Interestingly, though, if you look for unallocated G-codes, there's a bunch of them out there that aren't used that you could reuse. M-codes,
the M-codes going from 1 to 100, these aren't used. But I would tend to avoid that. Now, if you look here, you can see that the codes range from 199 to 999. So I said, okay, fine, I'm just going to go just ahead of that and use 300, 301, and 302. So that's where we got the numbers for the M codes that I'm about to use. Now, you can get into this as deep as you want. I mean, they really have a bunch of stuff in here, but I just really didn't want to get into it that deeply, and we didn't really need to. So let's do this, and it's not as difficult as you would think. So you open up your INI file and scroll down until you get to that RS274NGC section. All right. Inside of there, their instructions said to put a user underscore M underscore path, and I did, and I made a directory called M-code, and that's where I put the routines. Now, that's fine and dandy, except it didn't work. I kept getting failures. Every single time I would try it, it would crash and burn and say that it couldn't find the routines. So I took the routines and I moved them into my other subroutine path, routines, with the rest of my stuff, and it worked. So I just said, okay, fine, I'm not going to put that user M path stuff in there. I'm just going to leave it in my plain routines because it works. Why? I don't know. It does. So this part here is the quote-unquote meat and potatoes of the whole thing. You see I've got remap, and then you give it whatever the name is. In this case, M300, M301, M302, okay? And it creates a path to your routine. And then if your routine exists, it's going to work, all right? Now, that modal group 10, I really had to do some digging to find out what it was. There's a whole bunch of different ones. 10 means it can pass variables back and forth and stuff like that. For what we're doing, this is going to work for you. So you do your remap, your M code, modal group equals 10, and then NGC equals whatever the name of the file is, like 300.ngc, 301.ngc, whatever. Here, let me show you my directory and you'll see what I mean. Yeah, so you can see if I go into my Frankenlab configuration, I've only got my images and my routines, and then I got all the stuff to make Frankenlab work. And you see I've got all my different routines. And see, there's my 300, 301, and 302 NGC files. All right, as long as they're in there, it can find them, and I'm very happy to just leave it in there with the rest of my routines. So, yeah. Okay, back to the Linux CNC machine. And you can see here, I've got gedit opened up, and we've got the M300 M code. And this was the first one I did, an experimental one. So what I'm doing is I'm doing an O for O word, and then in brackets the name of the thing, and then sub. And make sure that you use an O. I use a lowercase because if you put a zero, it doesn't work. And then at the end of it, you have to have the same name. So we've got the same O, M300, and sub. Okay? After that, it's pretty much simple. All this routine does is sets out a G21, puts it in metric mode, a G90, which puts it in absolute, and then sets it to our P1 coordinate system, the G54. That's all it did, and I tested it. It worked great, so I knew that then I could move along to the other ones for the M301 and 302. Let's take a look at those right now. All right, so now we're looking at the 301. 301 moves the machine from engraver to laser. So let's break it down. Line number 1, line number 12, we've got our header and footer, okay? Going into number 4, we're going to make sure that we're in P1, we're going to make sure that we're in absolute mode, and we're going to make sure that we're in metric mode. All right? I don't want the laser randomly firing, so I've got the routine, the M68, which means immediate action. And Q I've got set to 0, which is turn that thing off, 0 power. Alright, then I'm going to take the A axis, which is the laser, and the Z axis, which is the engraver, and I'm going to move them up 20 millimeters because I don't want them smashing into something. Then I'm going to make sure that my engraver is over top of the 0 point. Now that we've done that and I know where my coordinate system is, the G10L20 is going to say, for P1, the G54 group, I want you to take the X and offset it 1.9 millimeters. And I want you to take the Y and offset it 195 millimeters, which just happens to be the offset for this laser. Now that it's done that, internally that number is set. I'm telling it, go to 0, X0, Y0. And that's going to tell it to move to the new coordinate system. So now it's over top of where we want to cut, and we should be ready to fire the laser. Now this is going to presume, of course, that we've already focused the laser. If not, we could add routines in there, but I just wanted to keep it as simple as possible. Now, as you may have guessed, the M302 routine is pretty much the same thing. Again, we've got our same header and footer. We're going to make sure we're in P1. Going to make sure we're in metric, we're going to make sure that we're in absolute mode. I literally just copied that all over. Make sure the laser's off, make sure that the A-axis and the Z-axis are up 20 millimeters. Make sure that we're over top of the zero point. When we do all of that stuff, the only real difference in this routine is now when I reset the coordinates, you notice they're minus numbers. I'm telling it go back that amount of distance. All right? Then I tell it, okay, we're at the new coordinates, everything's been set up. Line 9 tells it to physically go there. The unit moves, and we're ready to cut. Again, we're going to presume that, you know, the Z was zeroed ahead of time. That's it. That's the whole routine. And by having those two routines in there and doing the setup that we saw earlier, we're done. We've got custom M codes. So I hope this helped you out. I'm going to have links. Make sure you go down to the description to find them. And I hope it helps you out. Thanks for watching.